and the gentle-hearted girl, forced by her own bitter distress to accuse others, wrung her hands in an uncontrollable agony of tears.
"You have been driven away!" exclaimed the king. "This is the second time I have heard that said."
"I have been driven away with shame and ignominy, sire. You see, then, that I have no other protector but heaven, no consolation but prayer, and this cloister is my only refuge."
"My palace, my whole court, shall be your park of peace." "Oh, fear nothing further now, Louise. Those, be they men or women, who yesterday drove you away, shall tomorrow tremble before you. Tomorrow, do I say. Nay, this very day I have already shown my displeasure, have already threatened. It is in my power, even now, to hurl the thunderbolt I have hitherto withheld. Louise, Louise, you shall be bitterly revenged. Tears of blood shall repay for the tears you have shed. Give me only the names of your enemies."
"Never, never."
"How can I show any anger, then?"
"Sire, those upon whom your anger would be prepared to fall would force you to draw back your hand upraised to punish."
"Oh, you do not know me," cried the king, exasperated. "Rather than draw back, I would sacrifice my kingdom and would abjure my family. Yes, I would strike until this arm had utterly destroyed all those who had ventured to make themselves the enemies of the gentlest and best of creatures."
And as he said these words, Louis struck his fist violently against the oaken wainscoting with a force which alarmed La Valliere, for his anger, owing to his unbounded power, had something imposing and threatening in it, like the lightning, which may at any time prove deadly. She, who thought that her own sufferings could not be surpassed, was overwhelmed by a suffering which revealed itself by menace and by violence. "Sire," she said, "for the last time, I implore you to leave me. Already do I feel strengthened by the calm seclusion of this asylum, and the protection of heaven has reassured me. For all the petty human meanness of this world are forgotten beneath the divine protection. Once more, then, sire, and for the last time, I implore you to leave me."
"Confess, rather," cried Louis, "that you have never loved me. Admit that my humility and my repentance are flattering to your pride, but that my distress affects you not. That the king of this wide realm is no longer regarded as a lover whose tenderness of devotion is capable of working out your happiness, but as a despot whose caprice has crushed your very heart beneath his iron heel. Do not say you are seeking heaven. Say, rather, you are fleeing from the king."
Louise's heart was wrung within her as she listened to his passionate utterance, which made the fever of hope course once more through her every vein. "But did you not hear me say that I have been driven away, scorned, despised?"
"I will make you the most respected and most adored and the most envied of my whole court,"